Planning Committee. My name is Councillor Anita Leech and I'm the Chair of the Committee. My role this evening is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly, having regard to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain who the rest of the people on the table here tonight are, to my immediate right is the Council Solicitor, who will give advice to the committee on any procedural or legal matters that might arise. To my left are the Council's Planning Officers, Highway Engineer and Environmental Health Officer, who will present the applications this evening and give any technical advice to the committee which may be sought. The rest of the people you see down both sides of the tables are the elected members who will consider the application this evening and make the decisions. Before each application is considered, there will be a short presentation by the planning officers. In the event that an application has received a qualifying petition signed by 25 signatures or more, one representative of the petition will be invited to address the committee in support of the petition for up to 5 minutes. If a petitioner addresses the committee, then the applicant or their agent will be invited to make representations to the committee in support of their application, again for up to 5 minutes. However, if a petitioner has not addressed the committee, then the applicant or their agent will not be invited to make any representations. A ward councillor can address the committee in relation to an application. The ward councillor may speak on behalf of the residents. However, once the ward councillor has returned to the public gallery, they may not return to take part in any further debate that may be followed by the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, who will then make a decision on the application. If a site visit is requested and approved by the committee, that matter will not be discussed this evening and will be discussed following the meeting taking place. Okay? Committee, could I have approval for the last minutes, please, on pages 1 to 28?
Yes.
Are there any declarations of interest? No. Are there any requests for site visits? Okay. Jeff?
On my first time, Chair. Agenda item number 5, please, Chair, given the importance of the site. It would be beneficial for us to have a site visit.
Okay, Denise.
Agenda item number 4, which is Pearshall House School, Playing Field. Due to the amount of public concern,
any other site visits? Okay, are we happy to approve site visits for agenda item 4, Pearshall House School, Playing Fields, and 5, land adjacent to the rectory, Mark, right? Okay, for those who are here for that those two applications, we won't be discussing it any further this evening. We will have the site visit before it's actually debated by committee. So if you want to leave now, you're quite welcome to do so. We'll just give you a couple of minutes to get yourselves together. But you're quite happy to stay if you want to. The site visit will be on the 16th of February and you will be noted, the lead petitioner will be notified. Thank you. Okay, for the purposes of the committee, the site visits will be on the 16th of February at 10 a.m. Okay, Matthew, if you move to agenda item 6, your presentation please.
Thank you, through you, Chair. This application seeks permission for the residential development of this site with up to 75 units. The application is an outline with details relating to appearance, scale, layout and landscaping reserved for further approval. Access details are submitted at this stage for approval. The site is designated as primarily industrial in the unitary development plan, and is also located within a health and safety executive consultation zone. the development proposed may notify all hazards. The proposals are a departure from the development plan. The Wirral International Business Park is identified as a primary focus for new employment uses supporting the economic revitalisation of the borough. Both the UDP and Emerging Core Strategy assess the need for residential development against the need for employment-based land use, together with the potential impacts on the character of an area and compatibility with neighbouring uses. The report presented to members this evening details the issue of employment land and explains that due to the quality and location of the business park, it is still a strategically important part of the borough's employment land portfolio. It is not considered that the potential benefits set out by the applicant of this application, if approved, would outweigh the loss of this site for employment use. The introduction of residential use in this location also has the potential to prejudice the prospects of comprehensive employment development within remaining land of the Riverside Park complex. The site also falls within an inner zone of the Health and Safety Executive's notification area, having regard to premises where a hazardous substances consent is in place for the storage and use of a variety of chemicals. Although that premises closed in May 2015 and hazardous substances removed, the consent remains in place and the company operating the site have indicated that the site is to be advertised on the open market. A response from that company following inquiries made to them from the council confirmed that the company are not looking to revoke the hazardous substance consent that is in place. The prospects of that consent being taken up by another occupier, therefore, cannot be ruled out. The Health and Safety Executive have confirmed that there are sufficient reasons on safety grounds against the grant of the Planning Commission. Although the application is submitted in outline, as an indicative master plan has been submitted that shows an L-shaped block of flats with a large area of car parking in front of the site. As has been outlined, the surrounding area is industrial in nature, and the site itself is allocated for industrial use. The introduction of a residential use would result in a change in the character of the area that would be detrimental and at odds with the site's designation and surrounding land uses. Future residents of the apartments would be subjected to the day-to-day impacts of living within an industrial estate, and both new and existing businesses would need to operate with residential amenity in mind, potentially restricting and limiting potential for growth and continued operations. The development proposed would result in the loss of designated employment land, which is strategically important and has the potential to significantly harm the need for employment land to maximise job opportunities within the borough. Whilst attempts have been made to demonstrate that there is no interest in this site for employment, the evidence submitted is insufficiently robust to support the loss of this site for residential use, particularly in light of continued development elsewhere in the business park, and latest market signals indicating that the country is emerging from the worst excess of the recession. Official statistics indicate the number of private sector jobs and new businesses are increasing, including on the Wirral, and therefore it is considered premature to say the site will not be of interest to future employment operators. There has also been a lack of information submitted around the effect of the development on wildlife, or its habitat, particularly having regards to nearby surrounding sites of biological importance. The development of the site for residential use is at odds with its land use designation and surrounding land use, and is not considered to constitute sustainable development. For the six reasons set out at the end of your report, it is recommended that this application is refused. There is no petition.
Thank you, Matthew. Is there more council would like to speak on this? Would you like to come forward?
Thank you, Chair. I understand where Matthew and planning officers are coming from on this one. I also understand that I personally have been here to this committee many times. And in the three times that planning officers have actually said B1, B2, B8 use could not be converted to D2, as in leisure, that the planning committee, in its good decisions, have actually decided to change convert employment use, as in the area that this site is considered, to leisure use, creating jobs. This application obviously clearly is about housing, and when it comes down to the issue of the cone sites, this planning committee in the past has approved the storage of huge quantities of ammonium nitrate, which goes back occasionally with devastating effects. The issue is with cone sites is the Eastern Village, Councillor Mitchell will know this very well, is actually nearer to the coma centre than this site is. When it comes down to it, this site has been marketed for 10 years with only one tiny little sniff. The owner, who I've only met recently, reduced the price by a third and they still didn't develop. I actually do not feel that this site would be appropriate for industrial use. Next door to it is a high quality development of office use, which has not been taken up. Literally just up the road is the Gateway house, which again has not been filled. Those developments have been supported by additional funding from outside and are still not full. So, from my point of view, the argument about employment use is whether or not this site would generate employment use. When it comes down to it, we've also got numerous B1, B8, and B2, sorry, sites within the business park that actually are vacant and have been vacant for years. And I mean years, which is why the planning committee, in its wisdom, actually agreed to change the use from B1, B2, B8 to D2. It's scrubland, it's brownfield. We have an issue with the number of housing that we require on Wirral. I'm sure every member of the planning committee is aware that there are going to be changes to the planning legislation with regard to housing development. I just feel that it would be appropriate perhaps to redesignate this with a nice view over the river to housing.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you for that. Can I please talk to the committee, please?
Yeah, thanks, Jim. I think we're all in favour of housing, I certainly am. We do need more housing in the borough. I think Steve Niblock has obviously got a passionate belief that this is suitable for that situation. And in support of that, he does say that we have overturned officers' recommendations past for commercial, industrial, or whatever developments for them to end up as leisure uses, and I support each and every one of those, and I'm sure Steve will remember. I think the problem with this one is it isn't for leisure use, it isn't for that sort of activity at all, it's for a housing development, and I believe this to be an inappropriate application in an inappropriate location because of the fact people are not just going to come here to place board or to place wash or whatever, they're going to live there permanently, and I do not believe it is the right location for them to have houses. And in addition, for the other ones that we've approved, the leisure facility ones, if and when the leisure use lapsed in the future, these did revert to the use for which they were specifically designated originally. I can't see that happening with a housing development. One apparently without success for some time. I think going along with the officers, we should persevere and hope that someday, when the economy improves to the extent that this area can be given the use for which it was intended, employment use, I think we should turn this one down at this time. Thank you, Chair.
Steve? Similar vein, I did have a deal of sympathy with Councillor Blocker and his arguments, and you know, it is difficult to justify when a site's been marketed, and quotes of other industrial uses in the area are not being filled, and you do become to get frustrated. But I think, like you, David, the changes we've made from industry to leisure, we can associate leisure facilities with an employment. They do employ people on a permanent basis. The houses, although they create employment during their construction, after that they do not sustain any measurable employment. So clearly it's a big step. My concern about this application is that the developer hasn't gone far enough to answer the questions that the officers and the reasons for refusal that have been posed. And it's not for me to give developers advice, but for my time on the committee, it may have been wiser to withdraw this application and do a lot more work and a lot more presentations and evidence on some of the key points that the officer brought up. So I do have sympathy with sites. The other thing I would like to raise, and I know the Chair and other people, we have the Wirral plan, the 2020 vision of the Wirral plan, and one of the main ways of rejuvenating the borough is through increasing the number of houses that we build. A, you get money back from the government, and B, it does generate income and raises the council tax base and all the things that go with that. But one alongside in that plan, we also have the desire to create real jobs and further jobs in industrial sites. And this park is one of our key winners or key cards to play when we're attracting employment into Bullock. So it's a difficult decision. Well, it's not as difficult to make because I don't think the developers have argued their case strongly enough. That's my view. So I will certainly support the refusal.
I just wanted to make a few comments to support Steve, really. I was born and brought up in Bromborough. I was born in Heathrow Maternity Hospital, which is now a housing estate, played in Storkfield, which is now the retail park. Dad worked at Stork, Price's Chemicals, Mum worked at Mears Construction, Dad Magazine Lane, Bromborough Hall. And Bromborough has always had a history of being a mix of industrial and residential areas. And all the areas that Steve mentioned in relation to business parks, I know from that area that a lot are still empty. The place apparently is covered in knotweed, and although I understand that we have to keep some areas specifically for industrial use, we do know that in the future, whenever that may be, that rural waters will be up and coming. And I would hate to see that in 10 or 20 years' time, that piece of land is still being overgrown by knotweed when it could have been used for housing. That's my opinion.
Okay, David?
Being very short, Chair, if you look at the planning history of the site, originally it was just there, like Cathy, I'm the only one. I remember it being all just fields, and then Unilever decided to develop it and do something. Many, many years after Lord Leaver Hume changed his mind from having the oval in that particular area and moving it to Benton, people would be surprised. When you go down there, it's called Stadium Road, because that's where originally the Leaver Hume put the oval. This has been designated as industrial site, as Cathy just mentioned. We're looking to move the International Business Park just up the road from here. Obviously, that is successful in the views that the council wish to do. It will actually help to generate more jobs, hopefully, in this area. To designated housing, it's gone for good. In relation to Cllr sites, yes, Eastern Villages, surrounded by a common site. But that was put in with legislation changes. It wasn't done by a council. You've got to look at it, this particular area that we're looking at now. Over the years, there's been 15 planning applications for the site. 13 for industrial, which were all approved, and 2 for residential, which were refused. And I will continue that, and I agree with the recommendation.
Thank you. you want to speak, Joe?
I was going to speak, but it's all being said anyway. But I don't agree to disagree with me fellow councillor here, Stephen. Look, I'd move refusal on the grounds from reasons on pages 63 to 64, 1 to 6, as stated by the officers. I move refusal.
Okay, Dave, would you like to second it then? Okay. All those in favour of refusal based on the conditions listed? Against? Abstain? Okay, thank you. That application has been refused. We can now move on to agenda item 7, which is Boult and the Gaten. If you could pass presentation to the council.
Before I start the presentation, I just want to draw members' attention to one thing to have in their mind as I explain the application. On the top line in front of you, this dotted line here is the outline of the existing bungalow. And then this line here and this line here, that's the height of an earlier application that was withdrawn by the applicant, and then the large mass of the drawings, that's the application that's proposed. And then this is the site plan. So that's the site plan. Two dwellings, one sits slightly further forward than the other. I'll leave that one up if you want me to go back to the to the location plan, I can. But have in mind that the context of this application is to be read from Dawstone Road, because that's what it faces onto. This application was subject to a member's site visit on Monday. The proposals seek permission for the demolition of the existing dwelling and the redevelopment of the site with two new dwellings. The site is located within the primarily residential area, and therefore the principle of residential development is acceptable subject to policy HS4. The existing dwelling is a long and linear bungalow with a steep art and craft style roof. The frontage of the existing dwelling is set back some 20 metres from Dawstone Road. The site sits on the corner of Dawstone Road and Well Lane, with mature boundary landscaping down both sides. House types in the area vary in terms of size and type. A number of trees within the site are protected by tree preservation order. None of the protected trees are to be removed. While some trees within the site will be removed, a significant proportion of existing trees and landscaping features will be retained. Together with proposals to form part of a landscaping condition, the landscape characteristic of the site and area will not be harmed. The height of the proposed dwellings has been reduced since the previously withdrawn application. Each roof will be hipped to ensure a visual break between the two properties and minimise overall scale and mass. The appearance of the dwellings is considered to be acceptable. Separation distances are comfortably achieved, with dwellings opposite being over 40 metres away, and rear gardens with depths of over 20 metres, ensuring properties located at the rear on Well Lane have more than sufficient separation. The site is more than adequate to accommodate two dwellings, with satisfactory access arrangements achieved, off-street parking provided, and and significant amenity space retained for both new properties. The development is considered acceptable and is recommended for approval. There is no petition of objection in relation to these proposals. Just one slight amendment to condition 9 on your agenda papers. After the sentence where it says hedges or woodlands shown to be retained on the approved plan, and we want to insert the reference A103 revision A, so that a landscaping plan is carried into that specific plan.
Is there a
Councillor Andrew Hodson, has a word. Evening everyone and Happy New Year.
Thank you.
I don't know when you stop saying that. Right, I know you're already aware that some of you have been on to the site visit, but I do want to give all the facts here. The site of this planned development is at the corner of Well Lane and Dawson Road and has a large frontage of around 500 feet. Well Lane is an ancient lane unique in the West Wirral, and both it and Dawson Road lead down to the conservation areas in Gate and Lower Hessel Village, respectively. The site, therefore, is a particular sensitive one. And in September 2005, the council refused permission for a vehicle access from Well Lane to a house we built on a plot of land belonging to Dartlands in Gate Lane. The applicant appealed, the appeal was dismissed, and in the decision letter, the planning inspector wrote the following. I think you've all had copies. We have that passed around. Character and appearance of Well Lane changes markedly along its length. Some sections are clearly suburban in character, but the section in the vicinity of the appeal site has the distinct character and appearance of a country lane, with no footways and steep, well-tread, overgrown banks abutting the carriageway. In an area of extensive residential development such as this, a section of lane with such strongly defined rural qualities is something of a gem that does deserve safeguarding. The inspector continued, the proposed access would result in the removal of the frontage trees and large sections of the bank on which they stand. I acknowledge that the trees to be removed are not individually fine specimens, but they are valuable as part of the overall tree cover along this section of lane. And the planning application which you are considering marks the beginning of the section of our lane with precisely the characteristics he described. The planning officer's report confirms that the current application size is within the density and design guidelines area, gate and zone 2, and makes a general observation that the screening of properties by existing mature landscaping is a strong feature of the area. The report also says the application size is no exception to this, with a number of mature trees round the boundary of the site with Well Lane and Dawson Road. It says that the most significant trees have become protected by a tree preservation order, confirms that the guidelines under policy HS5 seek to retain this characteristic of mature boundary landscaping through generous building lines and plot frontages. However, the application as it currently stands does not do this. There are 62 trees listed in the applicant's own tree survey, and only 6 of these now have TPOs. The bulk of the remainder are described in the agricultural report as being generally good. However, no real value now under 10 years. It is proposed to remove various trees from some length of internal hedging, and I remind you of the inspector's statement about the importance of trees, which may not be fine specimens, but which are a valuable part of the overall tree cover. There is nothing in the proposed conditions which prevent a contractor removing or harming the non-TPO trees along the bank alongside Well Lane. Yet for the reasons stated by the inspector in the appeal I referred to, these are important to the character this gem of a lane. In my view, before any approval for this site is granted, the application should include a detailed landscape plan, and this plan should include the retention of existing non-protected trees and shrubs, and the protection of the banking along Well Lane referred to in the inspector's decision letter. Also, there should be additional boundary planting on the site. Without this landscaping plan, the application does not comply with the UD policy GR5, and this is not enough just to rely on conditions for such a plan. I would also ask that conditions relating to fencing, walls, gateways, and removal of permitted development rights should be applied to any approval. Finally, the officer's report says Welsh Water has no objection, subject to drainage conditions. I understand that most water says that the sewer network cannot take any further over the proposed controls over any additional discharge to sewers. However, no such condition is recommended in the officer's report, and yet this matter has significant health and safety implications. In conclusion, this proposed development in its present form would directly damage a unique area in Wirral, and I urge the committee to reject it. Just one more point. There has to be another battery course, I believe, which is supposed to take place between April and September. So those things are asked to be looked at, and put that as a condition to be done in those sorts of months. That would really help. Thank you for listening to me.
Thank you. Can I
open
this up to the committee, please?
Questions or observations? Thanks to those who didn't go on the site visit. It is a very large site. It is a prominent site on the corner, and there's a very beautiful part of our beautiful borough. The argument is, will this design and layout cause demonstrable harm? It would be a very difficult argument to say that it would. Now, the area is populated by large properties. There seems to be little or no effect on well laid, which is prominent in the councillor's discussion. So, in terms of the legislation we're faced with now and the application being of obviously good design and the protection that the officers have put in the conditions, especially about the A103 landscape plan, my view is that it is not ideal, and no application ever is ideal. No application should be judged against the dismissal of an appeal in 2005, and the world's moved on since 2005. So my view is that it is an acceptable application from my view of the site visit. People may disagree or agree.
David?
Thank you.
Yes, thanks, Chair. Well, actually, I was on the site visit the other day, and it was a very interesting site visit to take place on. I know the area very well. I've known it for about 50-odd years, so I know the area and how important it is to retain it. I think Andy Hodson, on the council of the area, has put forward this appeal decision by Derek Chu, but in all fairness, that was not for the property on Dawson Road. It was for property that was causing problems on Well Lane itself. And having looked at the two things in context, I do not believe that this development, as proposed, would have any adverse effect on the situation in Well Lane, which, as I say, I've known for years. I've actually got friends who live there, and they're not against it, by the way. But having said that, I think the design looks very acceptable. The site is large enough to accommodate this particular proposal. And in all fairness, I don't see any sustainable reason for refusing it that would withstand an appeal situation, because if Derek Chu, who was the appeal inspector on this occasion, looked at this one at this location, I'm afraid he would come to the conclusion that it was not the same as the one for Garthland's Gaten Lane. And I don't think you can use that as an argument for turning the development down. The other thing that I think is interesting, mate, and I'm just trying to find the page, I can't find it, on the conditions, page 69, we have got the question about, I think it was raised, by the councillor, before demolition the just conversion survey shall be carried out. That covers the bats. With the situation with landscaping and foliage, as you will know, we always put on these types of developments a condition to the effect that before any work is completed, the foliage and the landscaping will be covered. It is conditioned for that, as it is in all similar applications. So I think there's an undue fear being put forward in that context, which won't manifest itself in reality. So, in conclusion, I can understand why maybe the people in that area don't want to see something like this replacing one large single property, and that may be a valid position from their point of view, but that isn't a valid position from a planning perspective, and I don't see any sustainable, logical reason for turning down what looks like being a very appealing and attractive application. So I will be supporting this application.
Treena.
Thanks, Chair. I have to agree with my fellow councillors, Councillor Foulkes and Councillor Elderton. I also attended the site visit on Monday. I that will screen the properties, and I see no reason to object this proposal.
Dave?
Thank you, Chair. Yes, most of the points that I was going to make have already been made. I would pick up one point. The argument that was put forward by the local councillor was an appeal that was done 11 years ago. Legislation's changed dramatically since then. I've got to point that out to anybody who's listening. It has changed, and it's changed dramatically. We're still going through the process at the present moment with two sections going through government, the planning process and the housing bill. Both of those are having major effects on what's happening with decisions that we can make or can't make, considering what we used to be able to do 11 years ago. At the same point, I'm sure the planning inspector didn't go all the way down that road and have all the roads around the skates.
Joe?
Well,
side elevation, so that's in this corner of the site here. The bulk of the extensions occur to the west of the site, with a large extension proposed that will cover the existing pool area, so residents who are on the site pool is located here. It's currently an outdoor pool, but that will be covered over, and the extension projects further forward here, so it essentially covers this part of the site. So it will cover the existing pool area and provide for a new cinema room, utility room, gym and garage at ground floor, a mezzanine games room above the pool, and two additional bedrooms with a shared bathroom provided within the roof space at first floor. New dormer windows will be placed in the front roof plane. The extensions are significant in terms of scale, but the plot is a large one and the extensions will not appear cramped or give the site an overdeveloped appearance due to the size of the plot and the fact that additional accommodation at first floor level would be contained within the roof space. The nearest property is 47 Croft Drive East, so that's this property here which sits further forward of the application property. Windows on the side elevation of the application site are obscurely glazed, so for those members who are on the site visit, there were windows on this elevation of number 47, two of them on the first floor, and they're both obscurely glazed. Then there's a four-pane window bay at the back at ground floor, two windows facing the side southerly direction, one in the westerly direction, and one in the easterly direction, facing the application site. That window will undoubtedly experience some loss of some light as a result of the application. But we have to bear in mind that there are three other windows to that bay, two facing the south direction and another one facing west. So we've taken that into consideration and we don't feel that we could sustain a reason for refusal on the basis of any impact on that particular bay window. Given the ridge height will be lower than that of the existing dwelling, it's not considered that this development would appear overbearing or unneighbourly. In fact, the occupiers of 47 have not objected to these proposals. One objection has been received from neighbouring properties, and that's from the people who live at number 38, which is this property here north of the site. That property is located some 40 metres away, significantly in excess of the minimum separation distances that we would need to achieve. Although the proposals are significant in scale, the plot is large enough to take them without resulting in an overdeveloped or cramped appearance. A good distance is still maintained at the front of the site from Croft Drive East, and together with landscaping at the boundaries, the extensions will not appear incongruous in the street scene. The development proposed is considered to be acceptable and is recommended for approval. There is no petition in connection with this application.
Thank you, Matthew. So, Lord Councillor, would like to speak on this? If you could just state your name, please.
Councillor Geoffrey Wong, West Kirby and Thurston Ward. Thank you, Chairman, for allowing me to speak, and also to the members who came out